I think it's worthy of an extension here. Because when I talked about the idea of the little things that we can do, I simply wanted to emphasize that everybody can play a role, and everybody should play a role, because it's important in harnessing everybody's mind that there's a significant problem here. It's not some nebulous thing out there that we know it's a problem, but someone else has to take care of it. The government has to create some policy that's going to change emission standards, et cetera, that everybody has to play a role. So you start from the smallest level to the largest level. But the other issue about where we're going with energy policy is when we talk about investment in new green technologies, if we don't begin now, it's just this issue about drilling, it's about the issue of creating non-green technologies as well and investing in that. If we don't invest now in these green technologies, just like you suggest, if you don't drill now, then it's the longer you're putting it off. It's the longer you're putting it off now. And the question is, what amount of money are we going to invest in non-green technologies, because we need the oil, we need this, we need that. How much money are we going to make a massive commitment to green technologies and turn this around? Because the idea of putting lots of people out of work, I reject. If you invest in the green technologies now, you're going to create millions and millions of new jobs that we don't have now, all sorts of new industries, all sorts of new technologies that we can sell to the rest of the world. So I reject the notion that if we create some, not arbitrary, but certainly much higher standards than we've ever had before, we're going to be able to meet those targets, and we'll be able to do it in a green future.
I agree, and I'm glad we agree that they shouldn't be arbitrary. And I think that, first of all, to answer your question about how much we're going to invest, frankly, we have to figure out how much money we're going to have. It doesn't look like there's going to be a lot. And it's a question of how are we still going to achieve the goal that I think we agree on. Of green technologies. I think John McCain has been a champion of innovation for 30 years and understands that the United States needs to lead in innovation, and we have to catch up in a lot of areas too. Brazil is ahead of us on ethanol, and rightly so, because Brazil is focusing on the best kind of ethanol, and the United States is focusing on the worst. And unfortunately, Senator Obama wants to keep going in that direction. We have to start making sure that if we're going to invest in these technologies, we're going to go after the ones that make the most sense, and not just the ones that make sense during the Iowa caucuses and protecting the corn farmers. We have to make sure that we're going to be partnering with our friends around the world who are ahead of us and sharing in the benefits of those technologies. The current administration has actually initiated a policy of enormous amounts of investments in green technologies, with the goal of getting to cellulosic ethanol, which basically means you can cut the grass in your front yard, and that is what we use, grass, switchgrass, clippings. All of these things are things that we would use that are growing huge abundance in the United States to turn into energy and put it into your car, and that energy would actually burn cleaner than corn ethanol. And it's endlessly renewable and does not hurt the environment. We have to invest, and we're investing now, but the question is, are we going to have enough money to pay for what Senator Obama wants to do while at the same time keeping up these prohibitive, distorting tariffs on Brazilian ethanol and all of these subsidies for corn farmers to continue producing dirty, expensive, energy-wasting corn ethanol and forcing the price of corn up on the world market? That's hurting Mexico, it's hurting Central America, it's hurting Asia. I think that we have to have a president that understands that these things are interrelated.
I think we have one last video question. It's from Fernanda Avelino from here at the American School in Rio.
Hello, my name is Fernanda Avelino, and I'm a senior at the Escola Americana of Rio de Janeiro. I would like to ask both candidates, what can be done with a million immigrants already in the United States, and what can be done to prevent them from coming?
That's an excellent question, and I think that there's a lot of agreement actually between the two candidates on this. We have to reform immigration law, and we have to accept the reality that there are millions of illegal immigrants in the United States now, and that in fact they play a very vital role in the American way of life and in the American economy. And Senator McCain and Senator Obama both agree with that. There's a lot of shades of differences between exactly what we're going to do. I think, though, that to just put up a wall, both physically and metaphorically, is not an answer. We do have to secure our borders. I mean, if we're going to continue to open the door and let people come in illegally, obviously then the law means nothing. And that will distort our economy if it goes completely without any sort of regulation. But at the same token, I think that we have to get away from fear, and we have to get away from the sense that people from Latin America, people from Asia who've come to the United States in search of a better life are somehow taking away from the quality of life of the United States. That said, we have to, like we were talking about on foreign policy, you have to look at the motives of these people. They're not coming to the U.S. to steal and to subvert and to distort the U.S. economy for the Americans. They're coming in search of what all of us want. So you have to understand what are the motives and how do we change their behavior. How do we, first of all, encourage them to follow a legal route, and that legal route has to be made simpler and easier to understand, and it has to be fairer. But also, how do we make sure that we do all that we can to make sure where they live isn't such a hellhole that they're willing to risk their lives to come to the United States with no idea of whether or not there's going to be a job waiting for them and a life of persecution waiting for them as illegal immigrants? That's why free trade and integration of economies is a very, very important aspect to this question. And we have to do what we can to make their lives better where they live so they choose to stay where they live.
Steve?
Well, we're going to have a lot of time for another question because I can't say that I disagree with anything Kevin said.
Well, that's a good place to end it then.
Well, then let's. That concludes our mock presidential debate today. Thank you again to Kevin Ivers and Steve Spencer. Thanks to the students who participated and sent questions from around South America and people who took the time to watch us on the internet. Election Day, you'll remember, is November 4th, and if you're watching at home, go out and vote. If you're an American living abroad, make sure you get that absentee ballot in. And so on behalf of the American Society of Rio, the U.S. Consulate General in Rio, and the American School that has hosted us here in Rio, I'm Mac Margolis, and thanks again.
Oh my God, thank you. Very nice, thank you.